7. Proceeds go to the Make-A-Wish Foundation. Let's see, just remember the Summer Mission Project as we keep going through August, collecting things from community homes. Also, thank you to all the people who helped with the lunch for Doris Kennedy, who passed away and whose funeral was here. Let's see, also the flowers here are to remember Doris. Any other announcements?
I agree with thanking people for their work in the kitchen on Friday, but please mark your calendar for October 1st. It's a Saturday for Apple Pie Day. That way you have lots of notification. And if you have it on your calendar now, I'll have help on Apple Pie Day, October 1.
So October 1st is annual Apple Pie Day, and I'm assuming pretty quick somebody will be able to take orders for apple pies.
Yes, Emma is taking them, and you can only order 3 this year because we're only making 100 instead of larger amounts.
So you can place an order for apple pie with them. Any other announcements? Let's prepare our hearts then for this morning's worship service.
If you would please stand. Join me in the call to worship. People of God, what are we here to do?
To love the Lord our God with heart and soul, strength and might.
What are we here to do?
To love our neighbors as ourselves.
Our first hymn is number 464, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Bye.
please join me in the prayer of confession as is printed in the bulletin. Gracious God, Jesus tells us that our lives are enriched by loving you and loving our neighbors. We confess that love is hard for us. We are too selfish or too pessimistic, too hollow or too hardened, or just too tired to give ourselves to love's demands. Forgive our arrogance and our listlessness. Cleanse our hearts that we might find the strength to do what love requires and the grace to receive what love has to give. We pray in the name of Jesus, whose love has no boundary. Amen. Please offer your silent prayer of confession. Mercy ceaselessly flows from the heart of God. This is the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Please be seated. The New Testament lesson today is Luke 10, verses 25 through 37. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, what is written in the law? What do you read there? He answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, by on the other side, a Levite, when he came to the place, saw him and passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him. And when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to the man, bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he brought him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever you spend. Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? He said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, go and do likewise.
Thank you.
maybe there's no Team Jesus here, but we will talk about what they were going to talk about anyway. I brought with me a magnifying glass, and the reason I bought a magnifying glass is because when I collect coins or stamps, sometimes because my eyes aren't as good as they used to be, I have to use this magnifying glass to see what the date is or what it says on the coin or the stamp. And then I know what information it is that I was looking for. Well, sometimes in our faith, our eyes aren't as good as they should be either. We miss the things that God puts before us, and we kind of need a magnifying glass to help us to see the way God is calling us, the direction that God would have us to go. And so the Word of God and this opportunity that we have to gather and worship helps us to see the ways that God calls us to love our neighbors, the ways that God calls us to serve our community. So the scripture and the times that we have to fellowship and worship opens our eyes in a way that the Spirit moves us to know exactly which direction we would go or we would be called to go. So, you know, if I have a coin and I can't see the date real well, I can look and look and look, and until I put the magnifying glass in front of it, I'm pretty sure I won't be able to tell. But when we use the eyes that were given by the Spirit, that's like being able to see the date on the coin. We can see what God has in store for us, what the benefits to the people around us and to our hearts are. We see everything more clearly with using the lens of the love of our Savior Jesus Christ. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the wonderful blessing of your love and ask that you'd be with all of the children and all children of God, that each might see through the eyes of the Blessed Spirit. We give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. We come to the time now designated for the called congregational meeting that we are going to have today. So I'm going to, as the moderator, call the meeting to order, and let's open our congregational meeting with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessing of your love and the call to serve in a way that we hope and we pray honors and glorifies your dear and holy name. Come before us that we might see the wisdom of your Spirit shining a light on our path, in Jesus' name. Amen. So at this point, I would ask the clerk if we have a quorum.
Yes, we do. Thank
we have a quorum. I'm sorry, what?
19.
Okay. So we have a quorum of 19. And then at that, I would entertain a motion to dispense with the reading of the minutes from the last meeting.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. So the purpose of this meeting is to elect the officers that the nominating committee shall bring before us. And so at that point and to that end, I would call on the chair of the nominating committee for a report.
Nominating committee met in January and in early February, well ahead of calving season, I may note. And our members were Carlos Whitaker, Juan DeCross, Don Paulson, Dorothy Gibbs, and myself. Thanks everyone for your help. We came up with a slate of three elders. They are John Cross, Dorothy Gibbs, and Bill Letzler, all to serve a 3-year term. And for Deacon, Jan Cassini, for a 3-year term.
Thank you, Bill. You've heard the report of the nominating committee. If you didn't, there were put in nomination for the office of elder, Bill Metzler, Dorothy Gift, and John Cross for 3-year terms, and then also Jan Cassini as deacon for a 3-year term. Let's start with the Elders, the nominees have been placed before you. Are there nominees from the floor?
I just have a question. Can Bill work it in with Kevin Season next year?
Yes. Okay. Any nominations from the floor? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion that the nominations cease and that we cast a unanimous ballot for these nominees that the nominating committee has put forward.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Moved and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. The motion carries. And now on to the deacons. I would ask if there are any nominations from the floor for the office of deacon. Seeing none, I would entertain a motion to close the nominations and cast a unanimous ballot for the nominee that has been put forward.
So moved.
It's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries. Now, that is all the business that we had to bring forward. So I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
There's a motion. Second?
Second.
All in favor, please bow your heads and we will close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the wonderful blessing of your love. We ask that you would bless these officers chosen by the Spirit through the nominating committee of this church. Empower them to love and to serve in a way that brings honor to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We come now to the place during our time of worship where we share the reading from the Old Testament. We share Genesis 13. Hear now the blessing of God's word before us. So, Abram went up from Egypt, he and his wife and all that he had, and Lot with him, to Negev. Now, Abram was very rich in livestock and silver and gold. He journeyed on by stages from Negev as far as Bethel, to the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Alto, the place where he had made an altar at first. And there Abram called on the name of the Lord. Now Lot, who went with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents, and so the land could not support both of them living together, for their possessions were so great that they could not live together. And there was strife between the herders of Abram's livestock and the herders of Lot's livestock. At that time, the Canaanites and the Perizzites lived in the land also. Then Abram said to Lot, "Let there be no strife between you and me, and between your herders and my herders, for we are kindred. Is not the whole land before you? Separate yourself from me. If you take the left hand, then I will go to the right, or if you take the right hand, I will go to the left." Lot looked about him and saw that the plain of Jordan was well watered everywhere, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt in the direction of Zoar. This was before the Lord had destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So Lot chose for himself all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed eastward. Thus they separated from each other. Abram settled in the land of Canaan, while Lot settled among the cities of the plain and moved his tent as far as Sodom. Now, the people of Sodom were wicked, great sinners against the Lord. The Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated from him, "Raise your eyes now and look from the place where you are northward and southward and eastward and westward. For all of the land that you see, I will give to you and your offspring forever. I will make your offspring like the dust of the earth, so that if one can count the dust of the earth, your offspring also can be counted. Rise up, walk through the length of the, and breadth of the land, for I will give it to you. So Abram moved his tent and came and settled by the oaks of Mamre, which are at Hebron, and there he built an altar to the Lord. Here ends this blessed reading that comes to us from the Old Testament reading today, and it is the word of the Lord. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, grant us wisdom in the hearing of God's word. We open our hearts to all the possibilities that come when we dwell within the word of God. Hear our prayer now, that we might see a light shining on our path by the Spirit's blessing, in Jesus' name. Amen. The passage we've shared today continues from the message of 2 weeks ago, where Abram and his people went to Egypt as a response to a great famine in the land. So today we are in chapter 13 of Genesis, and we pick up where Abram and Sarah and Lot are returning from Egypt, and they land in the region of Negev, which is in the southern part of what Israel is now today. The scripture says that from the region of Negev, Abram returned to Bethel. And you remember from a couple of weeks ago, Bethel along with Shechem, in that area is where this community ended up first when they arrived in Canaan. That's where he built an altar to the Lord, thus receiving the call and answering the call that he had to be the chosen nation of Israel. The scripture says that Abram had become very wealthy. He had silver and gold and lots of livestock. While they were in Bethel, Lot was there with him. They had been a company since the time that they left Ur. And Lot also was wealthy. He had silver and gold and livestock also. And as it turns out, that the land they were occupying was not going to support Lot's livestock and Abram's livestock. And because that was true, there began to be quarreling between the herdsmen of Abram and the herdsmen of Lot. And to make matters worse, they weren't the only people living on the land. There were Canaanites and others that were trying to raise their livestock as well. So Abram and Lot, they got together, tried to cook up a solution. How can we solve this problem? Let there be no strife between our people, our herdsmen. Let there be no quarreling between you and me or between our herdsmen, is what the scripture says. Is not the whole land before us? So Abram, in his wisdom, says, let's part company. If you go to the left, I will go right. If you go to the right, I will go to the left. And so Abram left the decision to Lot, and in essence, left the decision to God. So Lot looked up and he saw the whole plain to the east of the Jordan River was green and plush. It looked like the garden of the Lord. And so that's where Lot went. He went east. So the two men parted company, and their communities parted company with no animosity between them. Abram lived in the land of Canaan, which is the land that God had ordained him to occupy. And Lot lived among the cities of the Jordan Plain. He pitched his tent near Sodom, which in today's terms, Sodom is right at the very southern tip of the Dead Sea. After Lot parted from Abram. The Lord said to Abram, lift up your eyes. From where you are, look north, south, and east and west. All the land that you see, I am going to give to your offspring. And your offspring will be as many as the particles of dust on the ground, and they will have this land they were chosen to have forever. Go and walk through the land, for I am giving it to you. So Abram travels the land, and he in the end pitches his tent in Hebron, which is in what is now southern Israel, and Lot in the area of Sodom, way at the south end of the Dead Sea. And it was green and lush, like the garden of the Lord, like the scripture says. Now apparently, Hebron was not as green and lush as the land that Lot had chosen. But that didn't matter to Abram because he had learned a lesson. But if you think about it, now this was the same land that Abram left because there was a famine and he went to Egypt and got into that mess that we talked about several weeks ago. But now, it didn't matter because Abram had learned the lesson that the Lord would provide. Then, he tried to control the whole thing and he put himself into a compromising position, compromising the safety of his wife and himself and the rest of the people. Then he tried to control. He tried to take control over his own destiny rather than putting his trust in the Lord. And that was the lesson that he learned. Now, Abram had gained the wisdom that the Lord would provide. Now, Abram knew that all that he had to do was trust in God. He now realized that God would provide for him and his family without Abram's desperate intervention. And beside all of that, we know, in hindsight, that Canaan was the land that God ordained for Abram to dwell in. When Abram conversed with Lot about the east or the west, Abram realized that no matter where he was in this world or what the land that was like that surrounded him, God would supply everything that he needed. He learned that peace and happiness and love don't come from prosperity of the land. He learned that the true measure of wealth is not silver and gold, not the amount of livestock that you own. Peace and happiness and love come from living in fellowship with God, from trusting in God and then realizing the bounty that God would provide. Wealth is measured, Abram learned, much more by kindred with God than it is silver and gold. Even in the face of hardship, and perhaps even more so in the face of hardship, faith in God is a treasure that will carry Abram through, and it's a treasure that will carry you and I through also. Let's put ourselves in Abram's shoes for a moment. I'll bet that all of us would have been tempted to take that green, lush valley, just like Lot decided. And Abram could have chosen that valley. He could have told Lot, you stay in the west, and I will go to the east where there is bounty. But Abram didn't do that. Because peace with his brother was more important than bounty in the land Abram's story has a lesson for you and me, I believe. A lesson that can shine light on our path. We live in a world where value is quantified. Let's face it, value is quantified by money, by possessions. So this lesson that Abram learned is probably one of the toughest ones for you and me to learn. Not only to learn, but how to put into practice that not everything is or should be quantified by money or possessions. This passage, I believe, can teach us much about decision making in our lives. Will we make decisions based on or with the intention of controlling our destiny all by ourselves? Or will we look at the situation we're in and make a decision trusting God? Will we make our decisions based on the communication of wealth in the world or according to the riches that God provides? Easy street or trusting in God even when God's way is far from easy street? Luxuries and conveniences over love, peace, and fellowship with God. I want to end today's meditation by sharing a couple of portions from the Gospel of Luke, beginning with verse 22. Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore, don't worry about your life, about what you will eat, about your body, what you will wear. Life is more than food, and the body more than clothes." And then in Luke 12:32, it says, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father is pleased to give you the kingdom. So sell all of your possessions and give to the poor. Provide for yourselves a purse that will never wear out, treasure in heaven that will never be exhausted. For where your treasure is, there is where your heart is." And I think that's the lesson that Abram learned. Trust in God, and God will deliver you. So I ask you this question: what decisions are coming up for you that require you to trust in God and not take it all onto yourself? What decisions are coming for you that God can help deliver the answer for? And then how will you decide? Will you choose the green, lush valley in pursuit of earthly riches, like it appears Lot did? Or will you remember this story about Abram and Lot and realize that peace in God's presence is not a function of prosperity, not a function of the bounty of the land, but rather a function of how much that you trust that God will supply your needs? As the little chorus in the song goes, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and God's righteousness, and then all of these things will be added to you." Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Living Lord, we come humbly before you today and ask that you would help us to understand that trusting in God above all other things, trusting in God sustains us and fulfills us and puts us to the place where God wants us to be. And so we pray this day that you will help us to see the wisdom of that truth, Help us to understand that we are not that different from Abram. And you are the same God that delivered Abram into the place that he was called and chosen to be. We give you praise for that blessing and ask that you would deliver us as well, that we might submit to the Spirit's call and praise God for that deliverance. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's come together today, and the hymn that we want to sing is number 388 rather than 389. Oh, Jesus, I have promised. Right? Prayer. couple of things I want to call to your attention. We want to keep the family of Doris Kennedy in our prayers at her passing. Also, people in Ukraine and other people who are the victims of war and poverty and difficulties in our world. We want to keep Joe Roberts, Joyce King, Robert DeVries, Gary Lovestead, Vicki Blair, Julie Shutt, Eleanor Garrison, Martha Green, Clint Dykoff, Dylan Preston, and Jackie Brown and Penny Peterson. Also, Jean Hughes has COVID, so I want to keep her in our prayers too. Are there others? Lynn?
Prayers for Ruby Graves. She is the aunt to Don and myself. She's from Galesburg. She had a heart attack, but she's in rehab.
So prayers for Ruby Graves, because of a mild heart attack. Others? Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that your wondrous love might accompany us as we take one step forward and then another as this church seeks to honor and glorify your dear and holy name. We ask, Lord, that you would grant peace to the family of Doris Kennedy. Just give them the peace that they need to move forward in the days to come at Doris's passing. I ask that you be in the hearts of all of those who are victims of violence, those who were victims of the shooting on the 4th of July, the refugees and those who suffer from the violence in Ukraine, and so many other ways where people experience hardship by poverty, by oppression, by homelessness and hunger. Lord, we ask that you just care for your children. We ask, Lord, that you continue to be with Joyce King and Eleanor Garrison, Alex Strandgaard, Barb Anderson, those who are not able to get out the way they would like to get out. Just be with them and help them to know they are an important part of the ministry of this congregation. We ask that you be with Robert DeVries and Gary Lovestead and Clint Dykoff and Dylan Preston. We ask, Lord, that you just be with these, your children, and help them to know that the Lord is standing by their side with every step of faith that they take. Just hear our prayer for them that they might see the joy of each day. We ask that you'd be with Joe Roberts and Martha Green, just as Martha goes through the cancer treatments and Joe goes through the treatments he's going through. Just lift up their lives and show them that you are holding their hands to get them through each day. We ask that you'd be with Vicki Blair and Jackie Brown and Julie Shutt. Just help them to know that the Lord is by their side in with each endeavor that they face, with each hardship, Lord, that you will hold them up and grant them grace and peace. We ask also, Lord, that you would continue to be with Penny Peterson, be with Jean Hughes as she goes through COVID. Just watch over her and as Penny recovers from the treatments that she went through. Just give her comfort and strength for each day. We ask also that you'd be with Ruby Grace at the heart attack as she recovers, that she might be made whole again by the wondrous love of our Savior Jesus Christ. With each step that passes, Lord, help us to have a vision of your direction for this congregation, that we might trust in you above all, and that we might see the treasure of a spirit-filled and spirit-led life. We ask, Lord, that you would continue to walk with us and shower us with the blessing. Bless the officers that were elected in your presence this day, that each might have the desire to serve you with their whole hearts, and that each might be blessed with a call and a direction to serve you and to be for your honor and glory. Lord, be present in our world. that each might hear his or her call, that the direction that we move as a country and a world might be focused on how we might move closer to you and to your peace. We pray now the prayer our Savior taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Let us prepare our hearts now to partake in the feast that our Lord has prepared. And those who are called to serve, come forward. Be seated. My friends, according to Luke, when the risen Lord was at the table with his disciples, he took bread and blessed it and broke it, and it was then that their eyes were opened and they recognized his risen presence was standing right before them in all of our Savior's glory. This is the Lord's table, and our Savior invites all of those who trust in him to join in this feast that he has prepared. Taste and see that the Lord is good and that his steadfast love endures forever. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come humbly before you and ask that your blessing would shine a light on our path so that we might have a clear vision as your chosen and called people to serve the world today in a way that helps the world to see the blessing of your presence. We ask, Lord, that as we take and eat according to your command, that you might fill us with the love and the peace and the call to serve that you have ordained for us. Holy, holy, holy is the name of the Lord, merciful and mighty on this day and forevermore. Amen. Today is a day, my friends, to give thanks to the Lord that on the night before he died, he took bread. He blessed it and broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said to them, Take and eat. This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, taking the cup and saying, This cup is the new covenant, which is sealed in my blood. Drink it. Whenever you drink it in remembrance of me, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. My dear friends, these are gifts from God, given to you and me, the people of God, to share together. Let us share them now. Thank you. My friends, the word of the Lord, take and eat. Dear Heavenly Father, we open our hearts that we might see your blessing, that we might feel your love and compassion, that we might experience your mercy and grace, and that we might see your presence this day and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated. Now, let us make ready to dedicate the offering that comes before us this week. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for the wonderful blessing, your presence in our hearts. May these gifts of love and grace be in our hearts and filter through our journeys. May all gifts of grace, love, and peace, and these gifts that come before us today be instruments of your purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us join and sing hymn number 447, Lead On, O King Eternal. Thank you.